Hi everyone, thanks for tuning in. This is the second video of a series of three about Betalink. Betalink is an open source software developed in our lab to connect Simlink with Betaflight. In this second video, we will learn how to flash and test a Betalink with a command line program. Be sure to check the first video given as a link directly here in the video and in the description.
So we end up here with the firmware that is in the obj directory. So you go to obj, into obj, and here you have your firmware. So now I will flash it. So to flash your firmware, only plug your flight controller to your laptop. First step, plug it. Okay. You do not have to connect the battery. It is powered by the USB. Then you launch Betaflight Configurator. Okay. It is detected here automatically. You can see it detects that on this TTY USB modem you have a serial link, an emulated serial link that is pointing that is connected to Betaflight. Okay, and it tells you even that it is a STM32F405. When you connect it, it populates some additional menus here. Since you didn't plug the LiPo battery, here the voltage is null, almost null. And I said that with Betaflight Configurator, you can pick up the name of the target. The target is here. You can read it here. IFRC, that is a prefix for the manufacturer. In fact, it is iFlight slash here. Next, it is the board name. So from iFlight, it is the iFlight F405 all in one. And within parentheses here, you have the name of the target that you use for the compilation. This is the name of the configuration. The configuration, the default configuration, is not compiled within the firmware. It is it comes in the form of a text file that should be that is specified during the flashing procedure. I will show you this. So now you push on, only have to push on update firmware. Here you have to select the right board, and there are a lot of board available. If you do not pick up the right board here, you will end up with a bad configuration file that is not adapted to your board, and it could hang, or it could have adverse effects, like the mapping of the motor will be incorrect, or such problems. So it is very important to pick up the right board name from the info that was displayed here. And then, since you compiled your own firmware, you have to load it locally here, pushing this button. And you are already in the right obj directory. This was just compiled. You select it. I advise you to switch on this selector for a full chip erase before flashing. It is safer. So you only have to push on the flash firmware button, and the whole procedure will be automatic. So first of all, it is erasing all the memory. Note that when you initiate the flashing procedure here, the flight controller switched into the DFU mode. DFU mode is a mode of the bootloader that is waiting, in fact, for a new firmware. If you might do some errors here. You might, for example, flash the incorrect target onto your board and end up with a board that cannot boot. If this happens at the end of the procedure here, it will not correctly reboot and you will not get here the possibility to connect to the flight controller. Here it will be blank. So here I have the info that it rebooted correctly. But if you have a problem, it is not the end of the world. You have to manually switch your board into the DFU mode. And to do this, you only have to push on the button here. There is a button on every flight controller. While you are plugging in the USB. So before plugging in the USB, you push this button, you maintain this button pushed while plugging in the USB, and then you will force the bootloader to enter the DFU mode, and you will have here DFU connection possibility, and you can reflash your firmware. So pretty robust procedure. I never bricked flight controller, finger crossed. Now we can test this firmware. First of all, we have to make some configuration. So when you connect, since you erased everything, you have to apply the custom defaults for your board. So just push on this apply custom defaults. It will automatically auto-configure your board with the default values. And the default values are almost the good ones for using Betalynx. Then when you connect the second time, you will have this warning about the uncalibrated IMU. All you have to do to make this message disappear after that, you have to calibrate the accelerometer. To do this, you can see here when I move the frame, the animation is moving accordingly. But when I put the frame on the table that is horizontal, you can see that it is not exactly horizontal on the animation. So you put it, your frame, you don't touch your frame, you put it on a horizontal surface and you push calibrate, and you can see that it corrects the offset of the IMU in order to have a perfect horizontal frame when it is physically horizontal. Okay, very easy. Then the only modifications that you have to do to all the configuration. Of course, you can modify what you want. It's compatible. For example, you might change here the main PID loop task frequency. It is also it is the same frequency for the PID that regulates the stability of the drone. Roll, yes, pitch, and yaw. And the same frequency, the same refresh rate is used for the motor velocity regulation by Betalynx. So if you want to change this, it is possible here in this menu. You should keep it as fast as possible. If you have some errors in the reports of the voltage here or the consumption, you can change here the gains for the onboard measurement of the current, of the voltage, and so on. and by doing your own calibration, which is possible in this menu. You can save your presets here. This tab is irrelevant when using Betalink, since you will have an external computer communicating with your flight controller and doing the stabilization of your drone. But if you want to fly with your flight controller without the Betalink feature, you can here tune the PID for the stabilization of your drone. It is not the tuning of the PID for the velocity. By the way, if you want to tune the PID of Betalink, you have to modify here some defines. It is hard-coded in the C code. I optimized this value for different kinds of motors. But of course, if you use very big motors or non-conventional motors like very high KV motors or very low KV motors, this might be not so stable that I tuned it for a standard motor for a 5-inch quadcopter. So you can tweak, you can modify the PI value of this controller here. Of course, it is a trial and error procedure. You have to reflash your firmware at every change, but there is only two parameters to tune, and you end up with a good tuning very quickly. Okay, this is for the tuning and receiver. When you use Betalink, you do not use a radio controller, but you might want to use it, for example, to activate some switches. And here you can make some tuning with respect to the radio control. Also here you can allocate signal coming from the radio controller to some actions of the flight controller. But the only configuration that you have to change here is in the motors tab. You have to switch on bidirectional D-shot. Very important. If you don't do this, the regulation will not work. It might yield a runaway of the motors, since the regulation thinks that the motor is not running, is not turning. When you do not have feedback, RPM feedback, in fact, you get zero, in fact, constant zero, despite the motor is turning. So the regulation thinks that the motor is not turning, so it sends, it increases the throttle up to the max, and this can yield not runaway of the motor. There is no risk of destruction of the motor, but the motor will turn very quickly. So a very important warning note. So you switch on this and you save and reboot. So it will reboot, you reconnect, you go there, and you can make some manual test here. But very important, first of all, to do your manual test, you have to switch this on here. I understand the risk. The propellers are removed. This is obvious. You do not make a test with powerful motors like this with the propellers mounted on the motor, of course. There is no risk of overheating the motor without the propeller. Of course, the propellers are dissipating more efficiently the heat produced by the motor, but since there is no props, The current within the motor is very low, so there is no Joule effect heating in the windings, and you can let the motor turn very long without risk of burning them. If you switch this bi-directional D-shot button, then it will add some info here. R is the RPM, the electrical RPM for each motor, and E is a percentage of error in the transmission, in the digital transmission. So if you plug a LiPo battery to your setup, so you can see I plugged the LiPo battery here, the voltage jumped to approximately 15 volts. It is a 4S battery. And I switch on here that I understand that I must remove the propellers. And here, by sliding this slider for motor one, I can check if the bidirectional D-shot is working. So you can see here, it displays the telemetry info here in real time. Also, the error is given, it should be zero. If you have some transmission error here, it is not normal. Okay, it works. So now we can check if Betalink works. First of all, you have to disconnect Betaflight configurator since two programs cannot access simultaneously to the same port, serial port, of course. So, in order to test Betalink with the command line program, we need first to compile the Betalink program. So you go to the Betalink directory, and first of all take a look at the code, and especially to the header of the code, and there are some flags and some defines that can be modified about the flags. So you should keep block standalone flag activated since obviously you want a main to be added to the code in order to be executable. So the second flag activates threaded update. So threaded update does not wait for the response. So you send the throttle or the velocity reference to the flight controller, and it process it, and then it replies with some telemetry data. With the threaded update, it sends okay the throttle value or velocity value, and after that, just after that, it instantiates. It launches a thread. It starts a thread, a listening thread, to the port that is in a wait state until the data arrives. This way of architecturing the code avoids the main code to block on the reply. And for a Simulink block, it is very important that the code of the Simulink block does not block, since during this state you cannot process other block, other tasks, and it is very important to have this threaded version in Simulink. But you can also test it with the command line. So when you activate it, since it doesn't wait for the response, it will display a ping duration. The ping duration is the duration between the sending of the command and the receiving of the response, since the response is non-blocking, since the call is non-blocking, it displays a ping that is not the real delay of the response, and it is so you will get a ping that is not accurate, very small but not accurate. If you want to measure accurately the ping, you have to disable the threaded version of the code. You can test it with two flight controllers simultaneously. With Simulink, you can have as many blocks, Betalink blocks, as you want. One Betalink block for one flight controller. You can, with the threaded version, there is also another problem, potential problem. If you send the command too quickly and the flight controller has no time to process it, not enough time to process it before you send the next command, then the responses will accumulate, will be buffered. Threads will be created for all buffered responses, waiting for these responses, and you may end up with a memory problem at some time. So if you want to limit the listening thread to one, just activate this flag. And if you want to have additional debug information, you can uncomment this flag. About the defines, each flight controller is identified by a serial number. So how to get the serial number? In fact, you have to make a dry run, a first dry run of the program. Of course, here you will have a bad serial number. I will put, for example, one. Okay. So it won't be able to connect, of course, but it will display for you the serial numbers of the devices that it has detected. So you can pick up this value, copy and paste it here, and it should work. If you want to test two flight controllers simultaneously, here you paste the second ID, the second serial number. So this should not be modified. This is the timeout for the response. If the response doesn't come within a time frame of 5 seconds, then it is considered lost. The program will make a defined amount of iteration. Here you can tune the number of iteration. Here it is 1000. So for loop iterating 1000 times and sending 1000 command and receiving 1000 telemetry data. You can wait between every iteration and tune this waiting time. Here it is 30 milliseconds. This is microseconds, so it is 30 milliseconds. It is a little bit high, so I will put here 12 milliseconds. Then here you can define the periodicity of the signal that you will send as throttle value or velocity reference to the flight controller. Here it is a velocity reference since it is over equal or greater than 3000. So it is interpreted by Betalink as a velocity reference. If I put here, for example, 1050, it will be interpreted as a throttle since it is between 1000 and 2000. So I will keep a velocity reference, and this will generate a step signal between 3000 and 3200. a square signal, which period is 200 times the period here. Okay, pretty straightforward. So to compile this, just look at notes. So here you have the explanation that I just gave you, and to compile it, just cut and paste this line here. You should have no warnings and, of course, no errors. Here the flag warning all is activated. So you launch Betalink. Oh, it will not work, of course, because I have the wrong serial number. But it will scan for Betaflight board. It throw an error initializing a serial port, but here on TTY USB modem, you have here it is the same value that you have here in Betaflight. TTY USB modem and this value, and you pick up the serial number here. Copy. You paste it here. In Betalink code, source code here. Save. You recompile Betalink, execute it, and it works. So now you are able to. So it displays here the response time. It is greater than my period. So here I think. No, it is not the threaded version, so it does not accumulate listening thread, so it's okay. You have an average response time of 16 milliseconds, a maximum response time of 32 milliseconds, a minimum response time of 12 milliseconds. It is displayed, the ping is displayed here in this column. Here you have the acceleration on XYZ. The gyro data here, the roll PTO, and the RPM of the motors. So it is the average RPM of all the motors. If you have a flight controller for four motors, it is the average of the velocity of the four motors. And you can see here, despite I have no battery connected, there are some non-null value of velocity. In fact, these are glitches due to the fact that the ESC is not powered since I did not connect the battery yet. There are sometimes some noise that is interpreted as telemetry data, and that gives you a non-null value here. But as soon as you power the ESC, these glitches will disappear, should disappear. Okay, and you saw that when I move the frame, of course, the acceleration and gyro data vary accordingly. Now, I will power on the board by plugging in the LiPo battery and rerun Betalink, and the motors should be turning at and switching between 3000 RPM and 3200 RPM. Just see. Okay. So you can see here it is regulated at 3000 and then it goes to 3200. And if you display on a plot, this value, it will be you will get the response time of the PID regulation loop. So to give you an idea, the rise time of this regulation is the order of magnitude is 30 milliseconds. So it is pretty fast. Of course, it depends on many factors. It is an order of magnitude, 30 milliseconds. It depends on the type of motor, the type of battery, the voltage of battery, the current limitation of the ESC, and so on. But it is a pretty fast regulation. Okay, one little thing that we could do in order to improve here the ping time for this F4 board is to make a little tweak using a Betaflight configurator. So I will connect it, go into the command line here. So in the command line mode, you can type here some additional command to make some more advanced configuration. You can go to notes here, and you can go to the advanced CLI tuning and change the update rate of the serial task. So the task that is polling the serial link to see if MSP commands arrive into the flight controller. So of course, by default, it is 100 Hz, so it is pretty slow. If you increase the polling frequency here, you can reduce the ping time. Do not forget to save your configuration, and then we can rerun Betalink. The average ping time decreased from 16 milliseconds to 10 milliseconds. But this is the best values that you can get on F4 MCU, and now we will flash another type of board, the other board that I show you, F7, and we will compare the ping time. And you will see that the ping time of F7, more powerful MCU, is far better. So I will disconnect my F4, connect F7. Okay. So now the F7 is connected. I will look what kind of board it is. STM32F7X2. It is a model Flywoo Dual, and the manufacturer is Flywoo. Okay, so the target name here is STM32F7X2. So when building Betalink, we have to add this new target name, F7X2. Okay. Finished. Okay, everything went without a warning or error. Perfect. Now we have to update the firmware. Just note the name of the board, Flywoo F7 Dual. So we go to firmware update. Here you have to select Flywoo F7 Dual. Okay, very important. This is the default configuration. And of course, you have to load here your local firmware. The ones that we just compiled here, and then you can with full chip arrays flash the firmware. Okay, should reboot. So I will disconnect and reconnect to see if it works. Yes, it works. So you connect, you apply the custom defaults, tributes. Okay, you reconnect, you calibrate the IMU, so calibrate accelerometer. Okay, it will add an offset in order to be horizontal. Okay, done. You activate here in motors the bidirectional D-shot. Save and reboot. And you can test Betalink with this new board, but of course, first of all, you have to copy paste the serial number. Now I run Betalink. Error, serial number is here. Copy, paste, save, compile, and execute. And you can see the ping value is the average ping value is pretty low. So it is increasing, it is the behavior is pretty strange here, but it is because we didn't tweak the refresh rate of the serial task. So we will do this now. Connect, CLI, paste, save. Okay. No, it should be more consistent. Yes. Sometimes you have greater values, but it is around 2 milliseconds. So the average is 2 milliseconds, the maximal ping is almost 6 milliseconds, and the minimum is less than 1 millisecond. So with an average ping time, so if you add some security margin, you can consider that if you have 3 millisecond sampling period, it will be okay. So you can run your high level control scheme at approximately 300 hertz, which is pretty good for a high level control for drones, considering the dynamics of the usual dynamics of drones. So this concludes this demo, this complete step-by-step walkthrough of building, explaining how to build, how to test with a command line program Betalink. In the next video that will be posted in some time, maybe 1 week, 2 weeks, I will explain how to use the Simulink block with Betalink. Thanks for watching. Goodbye.